Well, here we are in the perfectly pleasant city of Kenosha, Wisconsin, walking through the ruins that remain after national obsession. In the summer of 2020, on this block of cracked concrete, a cell phone captures what we've been told is a common occurrence in this country. A black man getting gunned down by a white police officer. The clip instantly goes viral, sparking days of mass protests and nights of violent riots. 3 days after the shooting, a baby-faced teenager comes to Kenosha with an AR-15. His night ends in fatal chaos and the birth of a new viral obsession, a murder trial that's must-watch TV. These twin tragedies were instantly beamed into every cranny of our lives, and yet no one knows what really happened. We're here to look beneath the lies we told ourselves about Kenosha. To find the catastrophe that wouldn't fit in the frame. August 22nd, 2020. Officer Rustin Shetsky fires 7 shots into the body of Jacob Blake. National media descends and quickly erects the 7 sacred tenets of Jacob Blake's martyrdom. The facts demonstrating the depths of this injustice. First, Blake had been breaking up a fight.
He was trying to break up a fight.
He was there to break up a fight.
Second, the police immediately escalated to deadly force.
You shoot first and you ask questions later.
They jumped straight to, this black man is gonna try kill us if we don't kill him first.
Third, Jacob Blake was unarmed.
Video of a police-involved shooting of an unarmed black man.
There was no weapon involved.
Fourth, he was getting into his own car.
As he walked around the front of his gray SUV.
Shot repeatedly while reaching into his car.
Fifth, Blake was shot in the back 7 times.
Shot 7 times in the back.
You see Jacob Blake get shot in the back 7 times.
Sixth, the police had endangered his children.
It was shot 7 times in the back in front of his children.
In front of his 3 young sons.
Seventh, the police used excessive force.
Brutal. Excessive force.
This felt like some sort of vendetta being taken out on a member of our community.
Blake survives, but his body is broken.
To all the young cats out there and even the older ones, your life could be taken from you like this, man.
Had an opportunity to spend some time with Jacob on the phone. He talked about how nothing was going to defeat him.
The next day in Orlando, Florida.
NBA teams refusing to play their scheduled games, a direct result of a shooting which took place in Kenosha, Wisconsin.
If you watch that video, you don't need to be black to be outraged. You need to be American and outraged.
The protests cascade, with athletes in professional soccer, tennis, and women's basketball also refusing to play in protest.
Whoever came up with that idea, it is striking. Jacob Blake shot 7 times in the back.
2 years later, no one, not the pundits or the politicians or the multimillionaire athletes, has been forced to confront that every single one of their sacred 7 is a lie, a flat-out fabrication.
The U.S. attorney out there in Wisconsin called me to brief me on it. It was very, very quickly, it was clear to me that this appeared to be a justified shooting, and it was not presented that way from the first moment.
Jacob Blake was not breaking up a fight. He'd been invited to attend the birthday party of one of the sons he has with LaQuisha Booker, another Kenosha native. They're unmarried and estranged. something makes him suspect she slept with a neighbor. There's a screaming match, and at 5:11 p.m., she makes this call to 911.
Yes, I need the officer to 2805 14th Street, Unit D. Jacob Blake is here, and he's not supposed to be here.
The police on the way found out that he had an outstanding felony warrant for sexual offense.
4 months earlier, Blake had broken into Booker's home, raped her with his finger, stolen her car, and made two $500 withdrawals from her bank account. She had filed charges.
That meant that they had to arrest him and take him into custody. There was no choice. They had to arrest him.
The police did not immediately escalate. 5:13 p.m., three officers arrive. Blake is loading two unidentified children into a vehicle. Officer Shesky immediately tries to arrest him.
He resisted from the very beginning. They tried two or three times to taser him.
They tased me right away down there.
Okay.
I ripped it out.
Okay.
I said, don't do that. So then they hit me again.
Okay.
And I'm like, I ripped that one out.
He wrestled with them. He fought with them. He overpowered them.
Blake headlocks Shesky, pulls him to the ground, stands up and starts walking around the front of the car. Jacob Blake was not unarmed.
That a witness had said that the police had yelled at him to drop the knife.
All right, were you carrying a knife?
Yeah, I had my knife.
You had a knife on you?
Yeah.
Okay.
That isn't his car. That's Laquisha Booker's car, and she's worried he's about to wreck it.
He's crashed numerous of my vehicles in the past, and I literally just bought one, like yesterday.
Blake was not shot in the back 7 times. An official state investigation later finds only 4 bullet holes in Blake's back. The other 3 are in his left flank, suggesting that the instant before Shesky shot, Blake may have been swinging back around to slash at him with the open knife in his right hand. The police were not endangering his children. Jacob Blake was. Laquisha Booker had told the officers, "He has my kids. My kids are in the car and he won't give me back my keys."
He was going into the car where there were kids. Once he had access to the kids, he could hold them hostage, or he could drive away threatening people in the community with a high-speed chase with kids in the car. What are the police supposed to do?
The force was not excessive. Officer Shesky perfectly followed protocols.
All these situations that use multiple shots, the media commonly does this. You know, so many shots were fired. Police officers will continue to squeeze off rounds until they actually see the result is no longer, you know, and there's no longer a threat.
After Blake is neutralized, Shesky immediately kneels down and starts administering CPR. He says to Blake, "You're going to be okay." So a supposed incident of white supremacist terror was in fact a white man preventing the kidnapping of 2 black boys. And our sports gods had been sanctifying the rapist of a black woman who'd been scheming to steal black children.
When I heard about Jacob Blake and I heard the standard media version, I knew that the black man with his hands up being shot by a white cop is a symbol. And you can feel where I'm going. There is a Jesus parallel to this. The idea that to be a black man is to walk about in danger of being iced by a white cop. And the question as to what that parable means in terms of correspondence with reality, you're not supposed to ask too many questions.
There are about 1,000 people shot and killed by the police a year. Of those, a quarter are African American. In only a very small fraction of cases is the individual unarmed, 5%. You know, less than a half a dozen a year, generally. There are over 60,000 dangerous attacks on police officers a year. It doesn't suggest gun-happy police officers.
The horrible thing is that we really are dealing with parables. It really is separate from the truth.
From the video that I saw, he's trying to get away from them. He's walking away. He's getting into his car as he gets shot 7 times in his back. I was there like the next day. Like, he got shot and I was there like the next day. Because, I mean, I'm a black man, so this was like not spectacle for me. This was real fucking life.
Did you follow the Jacob Blake case at all afterwards?
Yeah, I didn't follow any of it. Matter of fact, now that you bring it up, I'm like, wow, why didn't I? But no, I didn't follow any of it.
And then what we're dealing with is that racism is always just behind every tree, just under every rock. And a white cop, the second he or she gets nervous, is going to pull that gun.
That slavery mentality, like, you don't bow down to me, I'm going to shoot you in the back.
Your job is to believe in the legend rather than what actually happened.
They couldn't tase him. They couldn't do any of that stuff.
No, they did tase him. Yeah, they tased him twice.
You care more about showing that you know racism exists rather than caring about the children.
She was screaming at this police officer, like, don't let him take them.
You get no bigger advocate for black women and black women being heard and being understood and respected than me. But if you ask me, what about her concerns, my aunt, fuck her concerns.
You don't have to think, you just have to feel. Because when it comes to black people, everything is about feelings.
To make a film that then says, oh no, well, let's explore all the ways that Jacob Blake was wrong. It's just like, dang, for real? Like, the underlying thing is bullshit. It's just like, what? Like, for real?
So, attention is a limited resource. And in a moment of crisis, a lot of Americans just thought that this race narrative was what you should have given it to. I mean, outside of that, what else can you really say about Kenosha? But you seem to think there's an even deeper story or something. Well, what is it?
Let me start like this, okay? Burn away the media manufactured fiction about Jacob Blake. And what do you see? You see a bad man, but you ought to also see an abandoned boy. An abandoned boy who's just one tiny data point in a mass trend in this country. An unspoken catastrophe. The explosion in the number of boys who grow up without dads. This is Jacob Blake's father, Big Jake.
I got to go up and see my son today for the first time. He said, Daddy, I don't know why they shot me so many times. I said, son, they shouldn't have shot you at all.
30 years ago, he briefly dated and impregnated Julia Jackson. By the time their son is born, Big Jake has already impregnated a different woman and moved 700 miles away to North Carolina. Jacob Blake is part of the third of American boys that grows up without his dad. This is the highest rate in the world. There's an emerging science that the kind of basic, unglamorous rhythms of fatherhood are profoundly important for proper male development. Dads are especially important during adolescence. Primordial programming kicks in, flooding the boy's brain with testosterone, pushing him to take risks and seek adventure. And it naturally falls to fathers to train the boy's brain on how to channel that energy. All men are born into this ancient equation of human flourishing. And if that variable of father goes null, the chances that the boy's life will spin off into violent chaos jumps dramatically.
All the studies I've looked at over the years, going back 30 years when I was Attorney General the first time, showed that the thing that actually correlates most closely to whether a kid is going to go into a life of crime is whether or not they had a father who was involved in their lives.
I mean, it's just basic grandmother-grandfather wisdom says that you need two parents, and it's kind of remarkable hubris that we think that we can just get away with the single-parent homes and think that there won't be any consequences.
Before he's out of high school, Jacob Blake is building a rap sheet. Gun charges, disorderly conduct, trespassing. When he's 14, he gets sent to live with his dad in North Carolina.
But the father can't have any effect on him because he wasn't there from the beginning.
Well, so Jacob Blake is there for a year, and then he insists on returning back to live with his mom.
Whereas with his mom, he can be Jacob Blake, essentially.
A father fails his son. He deprives him of paternal order, and he sets him on a course of lawlessness that will culminate in the violent viral encounter that now defines Jacob Blake's whole life. And then after the shooting, the dad wants to stand up and say this.
My nature is to protect my son, to stand up for my son when he cannot stand up.
It's like, oh, so now you want to be a civil rights influencer. It's like, man, where were you when it mattered?
Yeah.
What gave them the right to attempted murder on my child?
Fatherless boys grow into unanchored men. We missed that story once in Kenosha. And then 72 hours later, we missed it again. The seven sacred tenets inspire thousands of protesters to descend on Kenosha, and the city is incinerated by a lie. On the third night of riots, 17-year-old Kyle Rittenhouse answers the call to come to Kenosha to protect a car dealership. He brings an AR-15 in a medic bag, and he ends up killing two people. He's tried for murder and acquitted. And we're presented with only two options for understanding him. He's an agent of white supremacy.
Rittenhouse will be the poster child for reactionary white men.
Allegedly, he's part of a militia.
Arguably a domestic terrorist.
Running around, shooting and killing protesters.
Or he's the baby-faced symbol of gun rights.
Welcome to Kyle Rittenhouse Appreciation Day.
Kyle Rittenhouse is not guilty, my friend.
It's the fake news turkey shoot. Got a laser gun going pew, pew, pew.
Okay, next question. Does a good dad allow his adolescent son to strap on an AR-15 and wander into a war zone? So Kyle's father is Mike Rittenhouse, a perpetually unemployed alcoholic. Mike punches his wife in the stomach when Kyle's four, and they divorce. So I found out Mike's only involvement in the nationally televised murder trial of his son is leaving late night drunken messages on the office phone of Kyle's lawyer. At what will almost certainly be the most desperate moment of Kyle's entire life, Mike hides in the shadows. That's the kind of dad he is.
If you could please make sure to pull that microphone close and speak as loud as you can into it. Thank you. Could you state your name for the record and spell your last name?
Richie McGinniss. Richie McGinniss. RichieMcGinniss.
I go up and I say, hey, is anyone willing to do an interview? And that was Kyle Rittenhouse sitting right there.
What brought you out here tonight? You just wanted to provide medical attention?
Provide medical attention to the people that need it if somebody's injured.
With Kyle, what I saw was almost a level of idealism and naivete that was at the point of stupidity.
There's only one member of the militia that is wandering around the streets and asking random violent rioters if they need medical attention.
Medical! EMS right here!
Does anybody need medical?
Does anybody need medical? Medical!
As he's saying, hey, I'm a medic, 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 anyone need attention? I'm hearing people say, fuck you, or hey, what do you think, you're in a movie, man? Huh?
Does anybody need medical?
Yeah, but it's like, I feel as if I'm feeding into the narrative that he's bad. Right. And I don't believe that. I believe he's good. You need some law enforcement. You need some, like, these people were just destroying people's lives.
Yeah, you don't need to think that he's a bad guy. You just need to think he's a teenager.
Oh, looks like we got some people over here. Okay, you guys keeping the peace?
Yes, sir.
You guys with the Kenosha guy?
That's where you see the first interaction with me and Kyle Rittenhouse.
Yeah, I live in Kenosha.
All right, on.
I've covered over 150 protests. If you mind your own business, you stay by your property, the odds are no one's gonna bother you. You don't want to look for trouble and stick your neck out there, because they'll give it to you.
You're gonna fall.
And don't poke the bear. Try to be respectful. Don't get attention unless you have to, because you don't know who you...
Dads protect sons from the dangers of their own naivete. And Kyle's naivete is the only reason you know his name.
Yeah.
So he gets detached from his militia minder, and he makes a fatal miscalculation, which is to go on his own, alone and unguarded, to another used car lot.
Right then, I see that same kid that I just interviewed running down the street with his AR, and in that exact moment, a figure came out of the dark part of the street, and that was Joseph Rosenbaum.
Joseph Rosenbaum is born in Waco, Texas, to unmarried parents. Early in his life, his dad is convicted of murder and dies in jail. Starting at age 10, Rosenbaum is regularly molested by his stepfather, who also forces him to watch him rape his brother. So the person charged with setting some of the essential foundations of this young boy's personality is entirely absent. And into that void steps a violent, inescapable tyrant. This dude's brain got broken before he hit puberty. Near his 18th birthday, he pleads guilty to committing child abuse and spends 9 years in jail. One of his victims later goes to jail as an adult for also abusing a boy. This is some sick inheritance passed between generations of men. So I got a copy of Rosenbaum's psychological evaluation from the Arizona penal system. And this psychologist, whose job is evaluating career criminals, calls Joseph Rosenbaum one of the most damaged individuals she's ever seen. So the morning of the rioting, he'd been discharged from a psych ward after a suicide attempt. He used his discharge bag from the psych hospital as a weapon against Rittenhouse. Anthony chases Kyle down and hits him with his skateboard, and Kyle shoots a single bullet clean through his chest cavity. Anthony was unwanted. He's born in Kenosha, and his dad tried to give him away as an infant. His dad, John, leaves Kenosha when Anthony's a baby and starts a new family in another state. Fatherlessness renders Anthony kind of existentially destabilized in all the predictable ways. He racks up a 20-page rap sheet. He spends large portions of his youth in this jail on the outskirts of the city. He joins the 85% of incarcerated males that don't have dads. Anthony lives in this house in Kenosha, and he finds psychic relief and a makeshift family in the local skateboarding community.
I skated with them basically since I first moved here, which was back when I was in like fifth, sixth grade.
Why do you think he was there that night? Would you say he was like a particularly political person?
No. Most of his life was on the skateboard.
I found out that John Huber, Anthony's dad, has launched a lawsuit against the city of Kenosha.
Yeah.
He's trying to collect a couple million dollars. And in that suit, he dares to describe Anthony as a beloved son.
We lost our son, and there's no justice right now for our family, and there's no closure.
This dude who abandoned Anthony as an infant is now trying to profit off of his dead son's corpse.
There's big issues here at hand that people have been sweeping under the rug for years, like racism in the police in Kenosha. And they've been sweeping under the rug for years, and the people are tired of it. People are tired of this stuff.
A father fails his son. A father fails his son. A father fails his son. And a father fails his son. And we get this. The abandoned and broken boys that grow into unanchored men. Do you see it now? Do you see the true catastrophe of Kenosha? Do you see the wretched kingdom sons will make when their dads disappear?